So, welcome everybody. This is Rethinking Pointers. My name is Jonathan Miller. I'm a German computer science student. And we'll be talking about pointers a lot today. The C++ Core guidelines give those two advices, which are reasonable. When transferring ownership, don't use a var pointer. Use a smart pointer instead. Only return t star to indicate some form of position. And yet, this is the interface of the allocator in the C++ standard library. It transfers ownership over the memory, yet it doesn't use a smart pointer. So, okay, probably people who use allocators are not the intended audience for the C++ Core guidelines. Maybe. Rules don't apply to them. This guideline states prefer t star over t ref when now argument is a valid option. And the examples actually show the opposite, namely use t ref over t star when you don't want null pointer. So instead of this function, you would probably pass a reference. And then the standard library has those two functions, which take pointers, where both of those pointers must not be null. The allocator constructor of polymorphic allocator and the destroy add function that calls the destructor of a type. Okay. And then there's also this. So I'm using a reference because this is a non-null pointer, right? So let's take a step back and rethink the guidelines. We rediscover them from scratch. It's not actually any new guidelines, just the process of discovering them might be helpful. And there are lots of pointer-like types, so the first thing we're going to do is create a taxonomy of them, group them into different categories, and then we'll look at every situation one by one and decide which pointer-like type we want there. So let's create a taxonomy. What do I mean by taxonomy? I'm only going to be looking at the interface of a pointer-like type. I don't care what your implementation does, whether you do fancy stuff with unused bits or have fancy pointers or whatever. I only care about the interface of your pointer-like type. So what's a pointer-like type? In my definition, a pointer-like type is a type whose value refers to some other entity. Usually when we have a type, we have an object of that type, we care about the value that object stores. With a pointer-like type, we don't care about the value of the pointer itself, only about the pointee of that pointer. And the pointee is the entity the pointer-like type refers to. And there are tons of pointers. We've got t-star, unique pointers, function pointers, string views, iterators, etc. Because this is just a 90-minute talk, we are going to group them further and only look at the first category, object pointer-like type. A pointer-like type where the value refers to an object. We've also got arrays, pointer-like type, there the value refers to multiple objects stored contiguously, or function pointer-like types where we refer to function or function-like objects. But I only have 90 minutes, so we're only going to be looking at object pointer-like type. I still have 200 slides anyway, so that's not an issue. This is some notation I'm going to be using throughout this talk, pretty straightforward. When I say TS, I refer to my type-safe library, and whenever I mean this, I say C pointer or T star, and when I mean that, I say C++ reference or T ref. When I'm going to say pointer, I mean any pointer-like type, not that. And when I'm going to say reference, I mean something different I'll introduce later on. Also, because there's no syntactic difference between an R value reference and a forwarding reference, I'm going to be using autoref when I mean forwarding reference. So let's create the taxonomy. The most basic property of a pointer-like type is the object access syntax. Given a pointer, how do I get the pointee? And when you have references, it's implicit. You can just use the reference, C++ reference, as if it was the pointee directly. Whereas with a plain pointer, you have to dereference them. For some other pointers, you might have to call some member functions or cast them. There's also void star, which provides no access. For the purposes of this taxonomy, I don't care about the exact syntax you use. I'm only going to be caring about whether or not you need an explicit syntax or you can just use it implicitly. So the distinction between implicit versus explicit access. And when a pointer-like type has implicit access, this means that every operation you've done on the pointer is actually done on the pointee. This refers to stuff like accessing members or comparing them or assigning them. All done on the pointee, not on the pointer. Yeah?
So incrementing a pointer?
When a pointer-like type has implicit access syntax, increment will increment the pointee. Because I get to that.
Okay.
So the other property is the opposite of that, the pointer creation. Given an object, how do you create a pointer? And similar, a C++ reference, it's done implicitly. For other pointers, you might have to take the address or use some function or combination of the two. And now we've got two properties. We have two values, so we can have this four quadrant diagram. Yes?
Where do proxy objects fit in this model?
Where do proxy objects fit in this model? So a proxy object would be something like stands for another object that refers to that. So it will usually have implicit access.
But is it a pointer, like, is an object pointer, like, object? Is it in this taxonomy at all? Is it, or is it something that you're considering outside of this discussion?
I haven't considered proxy objects for this talk at all.
Okay.
So I can't answer that question. And what you said with implicit access syntax, when you have a type with implicit creation and implicit access, this is, you can't increment such a pointer like type because you have implicit access. Because how would you distinguish between incrementing the pointer and incrementing the pointee when you have? Okay. So I'm going to call this concept the alias. This is a pointer like type that is an alias, and there's one implementation, a C++ reference, tref. That's an alias. Now, I've got a name for the other concept, and that name is really unfortunate, but naming is hard, and I don't really have a better word. I call this concept the reference concept. I know, it's unfortunate because pointers are references, whereas C++ references aren't references. But I don't know a better word. I could use pointer, but then it's confusing with pointer-like type. I like to mean pointer to mean alias or reference. So just going to stick with this one for now. We can bike shed a better one later. I'm sorry about that.
What about iterator?
Bike shed later. So these are the other two options, implicit creation and explicit access, and explicit creation and implicit access. This one will be discussed later on. This one is a little bit sad because it's usually impossible to implement. Why is that? Well, there is a built-in type with implicit access, a C++ reference, but it has implicit creation. So we need to write our own type. And when we try and do that with an explicit creation and implicit conversion, we can't really call member functions on that because we don't have operator dot. So when we want to have an explicit alias to a string, we would need to write an explicit string alias and forward every member function. This is similar to what standard string view does and is certainly possible, but usually this combination of pointer-like type in the general case is currently impossible. Let's talk about equality a bit because of the recent span discussion. So shallow equality, then there equals equals compares whether or not two pointers point to the same object. And with deep equality, equal equals compares the pointees. So it compares whether two pointers have pointees that compare equal. And I say when a pointer-like type has implicit access syntax, it should have deep equality. Simply because when you have implicit access syntax, every operation you do on the pointer is done on the pointee. So how, when you use equals equals to compare whether or not two pointers point to the same thing, how would you compare the pointees, the syntax already taken there? And on the other hand, if a pointer-like type has explicit access syntax, it should have shallow equality. Simply for consistency. You need special markup to access the pointee, so why not in that case as well? Now, let's take a quick detour and talk about standard span. It's an array pointer-like type for some range of memory, and you can use it like that. So it looks like it has implicit access, which means equality should be deep, which is what it currently is. However, implicit access for array pointer-like types with the array access operator is a little bit weirder because all array pointer-like types provide the array access operator and in a way have implicit access. There is no pointer-like type with explicit access when you want to get the fifth element of something.
Can you say that again?
When you have an array pointer-like type, so when you have an array, you use that operation to access the element. And when you have an array pointer-like type, you also use that operation to access the element. In a way, they all have implicit array access because it's the same operation. Okay?
Can I say that a different way, I think?
Yeah.
There's no API distinction for doing index access between an implicit and explicit access pointer.
Yeah, there is no API distinction in that case, correct. However, assignment of a span rebinds. So this is an operation that's not done on the pointee. If it was done on the pointee, it would copy every element over. This is an operation done on the pointer. It changes the pointer to something else. So in a way, span doesn't have implicit access. It has explicit access. And so equals equals should be a shallow equality and not a deep equality. Yes, Tom?
I came just in time.
You came just in time, correct. So, but I'm not going to be talking about span here, object pointer like types. Next property is mutability. Given a pointer, when I access the object, can I mutate it? How can I mutate it? And this is orthogonal to mutability of the pointer itself. It's a different question from can I change the pointer so that it points to something else? And I don't consider this property as important as the implicit creation or explicit creation. So I introduce that as a modifier. When I say alias, I don't say anything about mutability. When I say read-only alias, I say it's an alias that is read-only. So a const t ref, for example. Or a read-write reference is a t star. There is no type with write-only semantics, so we'll look at that later, whether or not we actually need that at all. For the next property, consider this code. All four pointers have something in common. What is that?
Immutable?
No. You can't dereference them. Let's call them valid versus invalid pointer. If you have a valid pointer, you can dereference them. If they are invalid, you cannot dereference them. And the prime example of invalid is null pointer. For reference, the first line doesn't compile, but the other ones do. So reference also has invalid references in a way. So when we talk about nullability, namely, is null pointer a valid value of this pointer-like type? Can it be null? The question is, why bother? If a pointer is non-null, it doesn't mean it's always valid. We just saw an example of that. However, when you see this those two functions, you might want to pass null pointer to the first one. You can't pass null pointer to the second one, so that's not a problem. However, you wouldn't willingly pass another invalid pointer-like type, like a pointer to deleted memory to the first one. If you do this, it's probably a bug. You didn't intend to do that. Likewise, you wouldn't pass a dangling reference to the second one.
Invalid, like you can't use it, and then there's a concept like it's null.
That's yeah, there is. So I explained the concept that's null. I'll show the full definition. But the concept of invalid is just a general one. Every pointer-like type can be invalid. There's no way to prevent that in
C++. Is there any way to check for it?
There is also no way to check for a generic invalid pointer without some compiler support or special libraries. Because you just can't check whether or not this reference points to dangling memory, for example.
And we use them, like one pass the end things are invalid pointers that are not nil.
Yeah. One pass the end is an example of an invalid pointer.
But
it's
not the same thing as invalid, is
it? I haven't considered. One pass the end is an array pointer like type. I'm not going to be talking about array pointer like types. So just sidestep that discussion. So anyways, what I want to say is in a valid program, we assume that every pointer can either be accessed or as null pointer. If there's a pointer-like type that can't be accessed, we wouldn't knowingly pass it around or use it anymore. This would be a bug. So when I say nullable, I mean either the pointer is null pointer or we can assume it's valid. And when I say non-null, we can assume it's valid. Yes.
A pointer that is, like in your example where I deleted something I pointed to, it is usable. That pointer could be reused.
It could be reused, but you can't dereference them. And there is this somewhat relation with a moved from object, I guess, yeah. Yes, Tony?
His definition of valid is dereferenceable. You know, like a pointer can be, in some sense, valid. You know, yeah, you can use that variable to assign to that variable, but his point is, is it dereferenceable or not? And he gives it this nice short word called valid.
I should have used dereferenceable instead of valid, but as we already see, I'm not good with names. Okay. So there's this nullable pointer concept in the standard library. It simply specifies a pointer-like type. So you have a default constructor that creates null pointer, converts from null pointer, can check from null pointer. And I'd also like to add explicit conversion operator bool, but that's not required, but I think it would be a nice addition. Now, when you have a nullable pointer-like type, it should model the nullable pointer concept. Seems pretty reasonable. However, this means that it cannot have implicit access syntax, because when it has implicit access syntax, comparison with null pointer would have been done on the pointee and not on the pointer. There's no syntax to check both. There's just one syntax, so we have to pick one or the other. This means that when I define the nullable modifier, it also changes the access syntax to explicit. So when we have a nullable alias, it has implicit creation, but explicit access and is nullable. Example would be boost optional QF. And this is also the case of the combination implicit access, implicit creation, explicit access I've mentioned on the four-quadrant diagram earlier. Note that T star, just based on this concept, is not a nullable alias because it has explicit creation. The concept nullable alias states implicit creation, so T star is not a nullable alias. And the other one's obvious. TS optional ref is from my TypeSafe library. Non-null is easy, just introduces non-null property requirement. So we have guideline support library non-null T star or my own object ref, but not T ref, because T ref has the completely wrong creation and access semantics to be the reference concept. Okay. And the last property I'm going to be looking at is owning. Pointer-like type is owning if it destroys the pointee when the pointer gets destroyed, like in this example here. And again, there are multiple forms of ownership, unique or shared ownership, but I'm not going to be caring a lot about those, just is it owning or is it not owning. Guideline for ownership, owning pointers should have explicit creation syntax. If you transfer ownership to something, this should not happen accidentally, so have an explicit creation syntax. This means that there is no alias with owning semantics. Now, I could do the same trick I did earlier and say an owning alias would have explicit creation and implicit access, but that's a combination that's usually impossible to implement. So I just say there are no owning alias pointer-like types. And implementations, we've got the smart pointers, and note that weak pointer is a non-owning reference because it doesn't actually destroy the pointee when it gets out of scope. So this is my taxonomy. I have two core concepts and then modifiers. Okay. And we can look at the implementations again. We've got our plane references or boost optional plane references here and no type that is white only. For non-owning references, we got object ref, non-null, or T star, optional ref, weak pointer, etc. And again, nothing for white only. And for owning, we only have nullable pointer-like types and no non-null. We look at those, whether or not we need them, how we would do them later on. So, any questions about my taxonomy? Okay. Let's begin with function parameters. I've classified them into seven different kinds with an orthogonal dimension necessity. Do I need to pass this parameter? Is it optional? The most basic one is an int parameter. This is a parameter that's only read by the function and not written to, like here this print and the square. Which pointer-like type do we want there? An alias, right?
Depends on what they do.
Depends on what they do? Why would, what do you mean by depend on the implementation?
I'm saying it's like required parameter.
Oh, yeah, I say these ones are not are required in this case. But it does like the core concept, reference or alias? Alias, right? Because we want convenient calling syntax and convenient access inside the function. So we use a read-only alias because it's an int parameter, it's nullable or non-null depending on the implementation, and it's non-owning. So constref or boost optional constref. So this means the code would look like this, right? But we wouldn't do that. We would pass the int by value. First, why is that possible? It's possible because a read-only non-owning alias is what I call transparent. We can replace it with the type it points to without any observed change in semantics. There's just an additional copy constructor call, and I don't consider that an observed change in semantics. So it's a transparent pointer-like type. Which means the full slide says pass by constref or by value if a type is small and trivially copyable, or you actually need to mutate a copy inside the function anyway.
What about cases where it could be modified outside of the function? They are different, aren't they? Like from the, like a reference could be modified during the execution of function externally. So it is, it isn't a locked in time thing.
Yeah, so in a multithreaded program, the reference could
check. Well, if you're in a function and you call a global function that modifies the thing that you were passing reference to. Don't do that, but
yeah. That can be hard to detect.
Exactly.
You're going to have to rely on, again, knowledge of program things that are external to the type for any of those.
Like C types of arguments or something that modifies the state of the program.
Let's, I have to go through a lot of slides, so
listen. I don't know if the semantics are exactly.
Yeah, probably, but in this situation, I mean, we would pass it by value, the int. So.
You might not get the same result in execution.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, but they are like guidelines, you know?
Yeah.
So I originally wanted to say that this was pretty uncontroversial, but it was controversial, so let's get even more controversial. Let's talk about T star versus boost optional TUF. In other words, do I need something like optional references? So let's take a look. We've got a prefix string function with an option not required in parameters using boost optional TUF. Call it like that or like that. Pretty straightforward. Bryce.
So is the std optional not support references, and that's why you're using boost optional?
std optional doesn't support references. That's why I'm using boost optional. Okay, yes. So looks like this. Now, when we want to do it with a pointer, we have to change the boost none to null pointer. And we also have to create a separate variable and pass the address. And that's somewhat awkward. I'd say you wouldn't actually want to do that when calling a function, because why do I care that the argument I'm passing is optional? I'm passing it to you anyway. So when you want to do that, you would need something like optional references. A pointer is not a replacement. What I'm not saying is that you need to do something like that. I'd say, why have parameters that are not required? You can overload them. You can use default values. There's a better mechanism than that. But if you want to do that, you would need an optional references and not a pointer. Whether we need optional references in the standard library, that's a different question, because I don't think it's a worthy addition. OK. Yes?
Why is a pointer not OK with this?
What?
Are you saying a pointer is OK here? No,
it's not OK, because you have to do more noise. More work to call the function.
Because you don't like the calling code?
Yeah, you have to, yeah. It's the explicit creation syntax versus implicit creation syntax. That's the issue here. OK. A persistent in parameter is something like a constructor argument. We read the value, and then we store a copy in a location that will outlive the function. So here, person creates a name and an age. And just from the concept point of view, we want the same concept, but we want a different implementation. We would always use const2f, we would always copy. So ideally, we'd overload, so move, or just pass by value if we don't want to have the two to then overloads, and performance isn't really important there. We could also use a constrained forwarding reference, but they are somewhat awkward. So in this case, I just pass by value. More interesting is a persistent pointer in parameter. This is a parameter where we store a pointer to the argument in the persistent location. Like the polymorphic allocator, it gets a pointer to a memory resource and will store that as a member variable. Now, I say we do not want alias there. We don't want alias there because of this guideline. If a function stores a pointer to an argument, you should find a way to make it visible in the call site. The reason is simple. Consider this function. We're creating returning an allocator, create the memory resource, and just return that. This is a bug, because the polymorphic allocator will store a pointer to that local variable. When we have explicit creation syntax, we would have to do something like this, and this just looks wrong. So, a bit of success when we don't have an alias there. So I'd say we want something with explicit creation and implicit access for convenience. However, that's the situation that's impossible to implement. So we compromise, explicit access, use a reference concept. In particular, it's non-owning, can be nullable, and can even be read-write depending on the semantics. So something like a plain pointer, object ref, optional ref, etc. And this is why the standard library has a pointer there and not a reference, even though this pointer cannot be null. So ideally, it would have used guideline support non null, but it's not in the standard. The opposite of an in parameter is an out parameter, a parameter only written to, never read. And standard file system is full of them. They all have the error code there. And I'm not going to argue that this is a great API design. It isn't. I'm just going to be looking at output parameters, which pointer like type do we want. And there's this guideline. When a function modifies a variable, try to make it visible in the call side. And it's somewhat controversial. So if you want to follow it, look here. If you don't want to follow it, look over there. The second situation is easier. That's an alias. However, again, that's the situation that's usually impossible to implement. But this is not usual, because we know every operation we want to do on the pointer-like type, namely just one, assigning. So we can easily write an output parameter type that provides the assignment operator, will just assign through. Oh, I originally had highlighting there, but you can't see that on the beamer. Never mind. So use that if you want to follow the guideline, or just use reference. I've got a more fully fledged implementation in TypeSafe, meaning code would look something like this. More on that in this blog post, links also at the end. Okay. An inline parameter is a combination of the two. We both read and write this container in order to sort it. And again, same guideline with the two options there. This time we actually have to can't compromise and have to use the reference concept. And again, only difference, now we have read-write instead of write-only. However, the guideline just states find a way to make it visible in the call side. And when you see a call to function called sort taking a single container and the return value is not used, I think it's pretty obvious from the call side that this function modifies the container. Otherwise, what's the point of calling it? So in this case, I'm actually fine with using an alias there. Thank you, Titus. I have difficulties coming up with examples for that, because such kind of parameters are somewhat rare. They're usually the this pointer in a member function. And then we don't have to worry about any pointer like type, and it's pretty obvious. This parameter is a little bit weird. I call it a consume parameter. This is a parameter where the function does the semantic destroy. Like this memory block struct, it's just a pointer and a size, non-owning. We've got a function to allocate it and to deallocate it. The deallocate block function does a semantic destroy. Turns it practically unusable, because now we have a memory block to memory that no longer exists. So it might be a good idea to find a way to make it visible in the call side, or even propagate the change back to the call side. So the deallocate block function could, in theory, reset the memory block to null pointer. Whether or not that's a good idea, something different. However, when we pass an R value, we don't need to make it explicit, because it doesn't matter that the object is turned practically unusable. There is no object after the call. And what you also figured out by now probably is that the right-hand side of a move constructor is a consume parameter. This time we even propagate the destroy back to the caller. So for that, use an R value reference. They don't really fit into my concept, so I don't bother there. And just for completeness, they can also be transparent. If you have a move-only type and are not in the special case, then you can just pass by value. You have to write standard move anyway. Final parameter type, forward parameter, pretty straightforward. Just forward some parameters. And the solution is also pretty straightforward, forwarding reference. Just for completeness thing. So those are function parameters. Any comments on that? Yes, Arthur.
For the consume one, we say pass by move, a lot of things, like, for example, std free, doesn't really consume the argument. It consumes the thing pointed to.
Yeah.
How does that, would you say you should pass void star ref there? Or does that fit into this?
It's also, so what about free? It doesn't consume the parameter, it consumes the thing it points to. Well, in the example I gave there, I also don't quite like it, because it's pretty obvious what deallocate block does and that it turns the memory block practically unusable. Same can be argued for free. So for free, I wouldn't actually use this pattern. I also wouldn't actually use it for deallocate block, but it's something I have not much experience with it. I'm just trying it out. Yes, Titus?
No, I like most of this. I think this is very well reasoned. Consume does concern me a little bit, because there's also something that's not expressed here, which is maybe consume.
Yeah, there's something.
And there are some.
Oh, wrong direction.
There are some examples of this that are already in the standard library or creeping in the standard library. And what you've just expressed is that consume and maybe consume are the same.
No, I'm saying when you have consume that is unconditionally, you can pass by value instead. Yeah.
The other part here is, I think you'll find that phrasing this as the semantics of an individual function might not capture all of what you want, and you may actually want to be looking at semantics of similarly called overload sets, because that actually gets you some of the consume question.
Yeah. So you make a point of looking at overload sets, but I'm also like, I think you're going to be talking about that.
I am.
So go to his talk tomorrow. Yes.
So you mentioned that in-out parameters are somewhat rare and then moved on. What about when like ranges introduces the ability to pass a range as that is modified? So for example, std sort my vector instead of passing iterators.
Yeah. Yeah. So I said they were rare and you gave a counter example. I still think the most functions don't have in-out parameters. They're the exception, not the norm. They're usually member functions.
Even if the ranges ecosystem is introduced to the standard?
Even if ranges, yeah.
And the naming, like Jonathan said, the naming of those things counts for a ton in understanding what the function parameter ought to be or what it's doing.
Yes, Jens?
But if you're looking for an example, get line, isn't that the classic in-out parameter example?
Get line example of an output parameter. Yes, this is a classical example of an output parameter, but not an in-out parameter, even though it might clear. Yeah. Yes?
Two things. If you want a plethora of examples of in-out parameters, sometimes even optional in-out parameters, look at the POSIX APIs.
Look at the POSIX.
They're full of them.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, but that's C, so.
But they're full of them.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah,
true, but if you want to see what you need to express, that's it. Okay, so.
Can I just point out I have levels 1 and we have still have to go through levels 2 through 5, so we can. And then these are the 90% guidelines. These are the usual advice we give, like don't use out parameters, pass by const to f, etc. So, opposite function parameters, return types. Classified those into 3, again. Availability as orthogonal dimension. But first, I'm not going to advocate for returning pointers to local variables. So I'm only going to be looking at the getter function, which is what I call a function where the object you return will outlive the function. In other words, it's safe to use a pointer like the classical getter function in the object-oriented sense. The first kind is a value getter. This is a getter function where object identity doesn't matter. In other words, it doesn't matter whether or not the caller operates on the exact same object as the one returned by the function to him. He can easily operate on a copy. It doesn't have to be the same string object, could have been a copy. It's less efficient, but it doesn't really matter. So for a value getter, we again want to read only alias. They are somewhat symmetrical to in-parameters with the same kind of optimization for small and trivially copyable types, meaning they look like this. Pretty straightforward. An object getter is a getter function where object identity matters. In other words, we want to operate on the exact same object than the one returned by the function. For example, the resource function of polymorphic allocator that gives us back the memory resource. It's important that user uses the same memory resource as given to him and not a copy, for example. I'm ignoring the fact that memory resource is not copyable just for the sake of this example. So just pretend it is. Because And this means this shouldn't return an alias, because then code like this has a bug. We are allocating memory on a copy of the resource, which is a distinct resource. It's an object that shouldn't be copied. The correct solution is one character away. We would have needed that. And this is not a good API if it's that easy to misuse. We want the pit of success. So what we want there is a reference. It can even be read-write, nullable, etc. So something like a pointer, which is precisely what the standard library did there. It returns a pointer. Vector.data. Yeah, but it returns a pointer for a different reason. Because that's an array pointer-like type.
Right.
I could do 3 more talks on array pointer-like types, but. And finally, an L-value getter. This is a getter function where you need to return a non-const L-value, like array access of vector, dereference operator. There is just no alternative to returning anything else. So it's pretty obvious what we need there. A deref, that's why they were added to the language, to allow this sort of operator overloads. So the functions look like this. But you shouldn't return tref for any other reason. If you don't want to allow assignment of your return value, don't return a tref. This would break encapsulation. You could simply make the member public anyway. It's the same thing. So, function parameters. Return types. And again, usual guidelines, return by value, or const tref, etc. Now, this is a good time to talk about something. Because there are multiple implementations of reference. Here are some non-null ones, here are some nullable ones. And you might say, well, why bother with all that complexity? This is a built-in type, so just use tstar everywhere. Well, you could, but then you have a function like this. Does this accept a pointer to a char or a string? Is it an optional argument? Can I pass null pointer? Can I pass a function local object? It doesn't tell us much. We should have used a pointer-like type with the right semantics, because then this function would look like this. It's more obvious what we can do with every one of these. This one accepts a string. This one wants a reference to a char, so we probably shouldn't be passing a local variable, etc. This gives us more information. And the reason it gives us more information is because tstar can do a lot of things. It can be a pointer to a single object, pointer to multiple objects, pointer to memory without any objects at all. The other types are not designed for that. So in interfaces, we want a reference implementation that is a vocabulary type for pointer to a single fully constructed object. I don't care what you do in your implementation, that's your thing, but in interfaces, you should use a vocabulary type. There is no vocabulary type in the standard library, so here are some candidates. Optional ref from my type-safe library in the nullable case, or observer pointer, which is in the TS since like forever and probably will never make it out of the TS. And in the non-null case, something like object ref. And GSL non-null is inferior to object ref because it's convertible from a pointer, not from object. So you need to like take the address and then create a non-null and not just do it in one step. So object ref from my type-safe library is a better implementation for that. However, you don't have those types, so I suggest following a similar order. Use a type perfectly designed for that, or the core guidelines, then a pointer, and only then a tref. And even you lose the nullability property, but you still gain explicit, which is more important than losing the nullability property, the non-null property, in my opinion. Yes, Titus?
Much like your argument of in-out parameters and the name of the function usually explains it.
Yeah.
I do note that your example here is foo and not necessarily a fair comparison.
Titus pointed out that I cheated a little bit because I didn't actually give the function a name. Yes, and you're probably right. There are situations where it's pretty obvious what the function does. However, there are also situations where it's pretty obvious that this const char pointer means string view, and we still have. So, yes?
So one other way of solving this is documenting your functions. And like I've seen it where there's a convention that unless otherwise specified, if you have a pointer which is passed as an argument, then it is a not null, not like vector, like single element. So that way, the documentation convention, you only need to add a documentation note for the exceptional case.
So you point out that you can have a convention where you mean a pointer in interface means it's non-null pointer to a single object. So in a way, you have a vocabulary type for a non-null pointer to a single object. You just use the same one you would use otherwise.
Unless otherwise specified.
Yeah. I still would prefer to have an actual real type, but I'm fine with that.
If we want not null and not owning, don't we want to try the reference before the pointer?
I'd say we don't, because the explicit creation semantics is, in my opinion, more important than the non-null semantics. So I'd be more willing to sacrifice non-null before. Okay. I just move on. Moving inside functions, short-term pointer storage. We've got four different situations. First one's for loop, iterate over vector, double every element, print every element. Again, we want an A-list there, read only or read write, and same optimization. Pretty straightforward, looks like this. Okay, let's change it to vector bool. Want to set everything to true, print everything out. Well, same situation, right? No, because vector bool doesn't actually give you a bool reference. It gives you a proxy object.
I thought you were going to talk about them.
I'm not going to be talking about. I'm going to be talking about avoiding pain with proxy objects. Not. So it returns a proxy object with overloaded operator equals. So in other words, we can't create a bool ref there. We have to use auto ref in that case, or just type out vector bool reference. But who's going to do that? This is also why I call it generic for loops, because in generic code, you might not know whether or not your users are crazy, so you have to guard against that and use autoref instead of tref inside generic.
Do you recommend using autoref everywhere where you're doing range 4?
Would I recommend using autoref everywhere when doing range 4? Well, sometimes I want const, so then obviously const autoref. And if I don't want const, this is more typing than autoref, so.
More character?
Yeah. I think it's more straightforward to use a reference there instead of a forwarding reference because, you know. Yeah, well, not important. We have value getters we'd like to call them. And if we'd like to call them multiple times, we might want to store them in a variable. However, we might want to avoid a copy, even though it doesn't matter whether or not we have a copy, it's just more efficient. So we want a pointer-like type. And it's obvious to use the same one returned by the value getter, constref, or boost optional constref, meaning it looks like this. Now, an audience at a different conference might get a little uneasy at this point, because what if the code looks like this? We have a function, returns it by value. Then we create a reference to that. Then we print that reference. But we have a reference to a temporary, so this doesn't work, right? Well, C++ actually tries to be helpful for once. Because lifetime extension kicks in, when we have a reference binding to a temporary, the lifetime of that temporary will be extended to match the lifetime of the reference. Now, I'm getting some looks there because I know terms and conditions may apply. It's C++, it's never that simple. In particular, when we do this, we actually do have a dangling reference. Why? Yes?
Only the first reference that binds to the temporary extends the lifetime.
Yes, only the first reference that binds to the temporary extends the lifetime. Particularly, max doesn't return a temporary, it returns a reference. So we just have a reference to a reference. There is no lifetime extension because no reference is I is not bound to a temporary. So it gets destroyed, and we have a problem. So don't rely on lifetime extension. Or maybe be very careful when relying on lifetime extension. So by conjecture, be very careful when using the value getter optimization. Only use it when it's like really important, and you're only calling a single function in this, in the expression. Now, the final one is a little bit weird, and named it forced L values because naming is hard. Now, Arthur, I'm talking about allocators here, but what I call allocator, you call heap. So those are the non-copyable objects that we actually care about, reference semantics there. So we have a memory block function allocating from an allocator and a function that will use that. Now, there are two kinds of allocators, stateful and stateless one. A stateless one would be like a wrapper over malloc free. A stateful one would have some data like a memory pool. But when we have a stateless allocator, we don't actually need to store them. We can simply construct one whenever we need it. This means that storage.get might return an allocator default constructed, or an allocator reference. Note that this doesn't follow the advice I gave earlier about not returning L value references unless you want assignment. But if this wasn't the case, this optimization wouldn't be possible. As I said, they're guidelines, not actual rules, so I've sacrificed them in this code. However, we have got a problem when we pass a stateless allocator, because storage.get returns a temporary, and this temporary will not bind to the non-const reference over there. So the code will not compile. problems clear? I just take that as a yes. We want to need to store the allocator somewhere, but we don't want to store a copy, so we store a pointer. And there's only one option there, so I'm not going to work around that. So autorefref. Now, what this means is that when storage.get returns an L-value reference, alloc will be deduced to be an L-value reference, and we pass an L-value reference to allocate block. Everything works. When storage.get returns the default constructor temporary, alloc will be deduced to be an R-value reference. And then we have a reference bound to a temporary, so lifetime extension will kick in, extend the lifetime of that temporary, and we can pass the R-value reference to the allocate block function. Yes?
So why not use autoRefRef everywhere?
Why not use autoRefRef anywhere, everywhere? Yeah.
And if you want it to be const, you can always use autoConstRef.
Yeah. So you made a good point of using autoRefRef anywhere. I don't have any arguments right now at any time to talk about arguments right now. Titus has arguments about that, so you can.
I mean, maybe if you are in generics. Yeah. But generics is not everywhere.
Anyways, I was done with my explanation because now we have an R-value reference. Call the allocate block function with that. The allocate block function expects an L-value reference, but an R-value reference is an L-value, as confusing as that is. C++ again. So those are the situations I classified as short-term pointer storage. And again, the common guideline for for loops, because the other ones aren't common. OK. Short-term pointer storage, let's talk about long-term pointer storage. In particular, let's talk about pointers inside members and containers. And before we can do that, we have to talk about this. When we create an object and create a copy of that object and mutate the object, we expect that the original object isn't changed. I mean, why would it be changed? We are mutating a copy. More formally expressed, a type has what I call logically independent assignment. If for every two pair of objects, if you mutate one, if you assign one, assign to one, it doesn't mutate the other as observed by assignment. More general, it's logically independent modifiable if that property applies to all mutations of members individually, as long as those members are propagated by assignment. Now, this is the pretty long text for something very easy, namely, when you have an int, create a copy of that int, mutate the copy, doesn't change the original int. When you have a string, mutate a copy of that string, doesn't change the original string. When you have a shared pointer, create a copy, and set the copy to null pointer, it doesn't actually mutate the original shared pointer. It decreases the use count of that shared pointer, but that is not a property that is being observed by assignment. So everything's good. And mouse types are logically independent modifiable, except tref, for example. Because when we do this code with references and create a copy of the reference and assign to the reference, we actually assign the pointee, which means that object is also changed. Actually, internally, the pointer implementation of the reference isn't changed, but we can't observe that because all we can observe is the pointee, because every operation done on the reference, C++ reference, gives us the pointee. Clear, right? Okay. Now with that, I can define the term copy regularity, which is a subset of Stepanov's regular types. Namely, it applies to copy constructible types that are copy assignable and logically independent modifiable. And I say, whenever you have a copy constructible type, it should be copy regular. It's obvious why I require the logically independent modifiability, but why do I require copy assignable? Any ideas? Okay. Copy assignment is just an optimization for destroy and copy construct. So if you provide both destroy and copy construct, you should also provide the combination of the two. And tref isn't copy regular. It's not logically independent modifiable. And constref is not even assignable. It's copy constructible, but we can't assign to it because it would change the pointee, and the pointee is const. And in fact, no alias type can be copy regular because it has implicit access semantics, so implicit access syntax. So every operation, including assignment, is done on the pointee. And when we assign the pointee, we also change the other references. This means do not use alias types for situations other than the one I've shown so far. Particular, do not use them inside as member variables, because how would you implement the assignment operator? You would have to somehow rebind the reference, and that is, well, it's not impossible, you can do that, but you shouldn't do that. Don't use references inside containers. You can try, but then you get an error message, a pretty long error message. It's the kind of error message that sort of just keeps on going, but only 12 errors. That's something. In particular, don't use references in generic code, so don't pass it, put them inside angle brackets unless the type or function explicitly states it can work with them, like boost optional to ref or type traits in the standard library. Okay. Yes?
Just a thought, like for convenience of sort of shortening complicated variables in code, or these are bad examples. What about using reference for that, like to just say it is referring to this other one?
What about using reference to this reference is just referring to something else? This is either the value getter optimization or forced L values. So I've covered those situations. Okay?
Or he also said local variables were okay.
Okay. So non-member containers. We want to represent some document written in Markdown, so we have an abstract non-copyable base class called markup entity, and want a container of those. They form our document. Let's look at the non-owning case first. Well, we can't use alias because the error message, so we want a non-owning reference. It's read-only or read-write, and it's usually non-null. I wrote a blog post saying it's always non-null, but I realized I made a mistake, so. Well, people pointed out that I made a mistake. So I wrote a follow-up blog post stating it's sometimes non-null. But it's usually a non-null. So when we want non-owning, I'd use object ref in this case. Why do we want owning pointers? Because owning pointers are a lot like just storing them directly, but sometimes we can't store them directly. Type could be non-copyable or non-movable, but we need copy or movability. Or the size isn't known at compile time, like here we've got polymorphic types, or using the pimple idiom. Or we want to store objects that should have a stable address. And unique pointer, which is a pointer-like type, is sometimes used as an RAII helper. I don't consider that to be in the scope of this talk. It's more a unique resource type, not a unique pointer, so I'm not covering that. And when we have an owning reference, we can either have unique ownership or shared ownership, but you should always prefer unique ownership. It's not only faster, it's also easier to reason about lifetimes and ownership, etc. So we've got nullable owning references, unique pointer, shared pointer, but we don't have non-null owning references. So let's just write a non-null unique pointer. Constructor, destructor. Yeah. We need a move constructor, and then we run into trouble, because what do we put there? We can't put equals null pointer, because then the moved from object is null pointer, and by definition, it's not nullable anymore. Now, there is a different discussion on whether or not you should be using moved from objects or whether or not it matters. I'm not going to go into that, but I'm just state. Yes, Titus?
The people that believe that this is okay because you shouldn't use moved from objects are also, I think, logically compelled to allow two-phase initialization.
Titus makes the point that people who say this is okay because you shouldn't be using moved from objects would also use two-phased need to find two-phase initialization okay for the same reason. For the purpose of this talk, I say this is impossible to implement. So there is no non-null unique pointer. We could write a non-null shared pointer, but why bother? Just use unique pointer. So we want reference again, this time owning, read-only or read-write, and nullable because there is no alternative. So a smart pointer, meaning looks like this. Okay. A member pointer, this is the last time I think I'm going to mention polymorphic allocator, the missing piece. How do we store the memory resource by pointer? Well, we want something non-owning. On the other case, we want to emphasize some text. In this case, we want an owning markup entity, the text that it will emphasize. And in the non-owning case, use reference, and ideally the same type as the in the constructor. It's just easier. So read only read write matches, nullable on null matches, and just use the same implementation you used in the constructor. In the owning case, we want an owning reference, nullable because there's no alternative, read only or read write. But when you have an owning reference, it's usually read write. I've never seen a read only smart pointer, but maybe that's just me. However, when you use a unique pointer as a member variable, you run into problems because most types should be copyable when that's possible. It's just value type, easier to reason about, do as the ints do. This means when you have a unique pointer, you need to write copy operations that do the proper semantics. This also applies to shared pointer because the copy semantics of shared pointer are not really the copy semantics you usually want in a copy constructor. It's logically non, yeah. What did I call that? Logically independent modifiable copy. Yeah. What term did you use in your talk?
Sherlock.
Sherlock, yeah, that's a much better term. I'm really not good at naming things. So this is somewhat annoying. Luckily, there's a proposal to help us, namely polymorphic value. It's simply a unique pointer with value semantics. Does the deep copy, works as we expected. This is the proposal. So for a member pointer, owning case, use something like polymorphic value instead of unique pointer, creates types that are easier to work with. I also want to point out, if we use type erasure, we wouldn't have this problem at all, but I'm deliberately not using type erasure here. And in the non-owning case, I'm assuming the standard library just stores a pointer. Okay, similar member container. Vector, a person has multiple children, and a person doesn't own their children, so non-owning pointers. And actually, in emphasize text, you can emphasize multiple things. So you can have like text, then some bold text, then other text. So we actually want a container there. And same guideline apply there. So I've used object ref there, and polymorphic value over there. Same guideline, if it should be copyable. So we should have a type that's copyable. Otherwise, we would need to write our own copy constructor. And in this case, we might even imagine a special container, polymorphic vector, that is like polymorphic value, but for multiple things, might do some fancy stuff inside the implementation. Okay. So it's funny how things go. Now I have more than enough time. So anybody want to discuss that? Of course you don't. So I put up the usual guidelines, but I don't think. Final level, let's talk about low-level memory manipulation. And this is the point where all my fancy taxonomy and concepts sort of break apart, because we now want things that are not expressed in there. It's just too low level in order for the fully abstract definitions we've been using earlier. I'm only going to be looking at three situations. There are countless more. So let's begin with untyped memory allocator. What do I mean by untyped memory? It's memory where are no objects in there, and we don't know which type will be stored in that memory. Or simply memory we know nothing about. So like some allocate function and some deallocate function. We don't even know which type we actually want there. And the, yes?
When would those occur?
When would those occur? So when would you have functions like this? You can think of malloc and free.
But it's only because they haven't given you that. So they don't transmit that knowledge around. Ultimately, somebody's asking for a size of being at some type.
Yeah, ultimately someone knows the type. But for example, you can implement a memory pool allocator for objects of size 4. And then it can return memory for any objects with size 4 bytes. So you don't know which type you actually want there. And you can make it a template, but then you have like code duplication just to have one thing. So a higher level API probably over that. OK. And yes, Bryce?
Sometimes it's useful to decouple
type, like, what are you going to do with memory, like what types of objects you can put into it?
I'm just going on, okay. So these types are especially weird because usually we have some object and want a pointer to that. But here we don't have objects. Instead, we just get a pointer to some memory. And the operating system usually gives us a void star, so we need a pointer like type with creation from void star. We don't really care about access, but maybe we want to like fill certain bytes in, like a debug fill, set everything to zero, but we don't really want to dereference the pointer. It can be nullable or non-null, depending on your API, etc. And it's non-owning because it's a low-level helper API. We don't actually want to have the overhead of smart pointers in there. So let's look at candidates for those. There are those four.
What about std aligned storage?
What about std aligned storage? Well, that's not a pointer.
I mean, not a pointer to a std aligned
storage. A pointer to a std aligned storage. Mm-hmm. That's a nice idea. Yeah, because you give more. Yeah, well, you still don't know that. Does std aligned storage want a type or an alignment?
It wants an alignment to the size.
It wants an alignment? Yeah, but you can't give it the size at compile time.
Well, if you want dynamic that.
Yeah. But something like a pointer alignment 4 could be, yeah, that could be a good idea, maybe. Yeah. I'll have to think more about that. So let's look at the implementation. The last three are sort of the same from the properties they have. They have bytewise access, bytewise pointer arithmetic, etc., whereas void star has no access and sadly no pointer arithmetic. When you call placement new, you actually technically have to cast it to a void star because some user might have a weird placement new overload that hijacks your pointer. See my lightning talk on Monday for that. So when you use the other types, you have to cast them to void star. Void star is also implicitly convertible from all other pointer types. The other ones aren't. Okay. Also, they have some certain semantic meaning. When you have a void star, it means untyped memory. When you have a char star, it can mean untyped memory or a C string. When you have an unsigned char, it can mean untyped memory or a pointer to a small integer. So that's why byte was added. It has the only meaning of pointer to untyped memory, but still has the same properties as char star and unsigned char. So based on that, we either want to have void star or byte star as our API. And because when you implement a memory allocator, you need to do a lot of pointer arithmetic. And it's really annoying that void star doesn't have pointer arithmetic. You always have to cast them to char, for example, do the arithmetic, then later have them decay back to void, cast again. It's annoying, so I would actually propose using byte star in your memory API. The only downside is now you can't use placement new easily, but I could imagine a standardized placement new for byte star that does the same thing as void star to leverage that problem. Okay. So maybe one day we have we will never have a malloc that returns a byte star, but I think it would be a good idea.
One question.
Yes.
Does having a pointer to byte star that is valid imply readability in the mythic context?
When you have a pointer that is valid, does that imply readability? No, not really.
If you have untyped memory, that still doesn't mean that it has a known value, right?
Yeah, when you don't know what's in that untyped memory. And as I said, in this chapter, my concepts sort of break apart.
Right.
Because we're doing.
So that's why void star, right? Because it's not readable.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though it's valid, it's not readable.
But, you know, yeah. But you also want to write maybe bytes to it, like fill it with all zeros, for example. And then byte star is more convenient than void star.
Sure, but
yeah.
Ideally,
I wouldn't want to void star with pointer arithmetic.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So, but you said type memory allocators, usually we want 1T. And this can be easily a wrapper over the untyped version. In this case, we want a pointer like type to a T. And there's not much point discussing it. We want a T star. Titus, are you? Okay, you're good. Now, let's say this is implemented using exceptions. So if there's no memory, we are going to throw an exception. Which, oh, yeah.
So I don't know if I want it to be a T star because for that very reason, there's not a T there yet.
You're not constructing, you're only allocating, right?
Yeah, you don't want a T star because there's no T there yet. But
so is it a valid pointer?
What?
Is it then in an invalid state?
It's an invalid pointer, yeah. But
that's why stutter line storage, because you know there's enough memory for a T there.
Yeah, there we could actually want a standard aligned storage, or like, yeah, that's a good point. But it's also like, we want a T star. Well, I could say we have a T star because later we want easy access to a T. But when we do like placement new on that, we can't use the original pointer anyway. We have to launder at first, so that's not really a good point. So
the line storage does not imply readable either.
Yeah, yeah.
It's
so
not writable, which is weird. But
so stutter line storage actually would be, yeah, I think that would be a great point to use stutter line storage.
And then also, doesn't the allocate, it has to take a non-valid pointer? It can't take a valid pointer because...
Yeah. A deallocate function, there should be no object there.
Yeah, but yeah. It can't be null.
Yeah. What?
Why don't you have allocate give you back the equivalent of like a unique pointer to an uninitialized unique pointer?
An uninitialized unique pointer, why not that? It's probably for a similar reason that you wouldn't actually want to implement standard list with a node for unique pointers, because then in the destructor you have like this recursive destruction of the list, and you would rather want to write a loop. I think at this level it makes sense to have owning raw pointers, because they are the low-level implementation.
I find the struggle with dealing with APIs like this is it's hard to make sure that you're being exception safe.
Yeah, it's difficult to use those APIs, definitely. And to be honest, I don't really like typed memory allocators anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wanted to raise a different question, namely there is a guideline support library non-null T star, and when we throw an exception on failure, it will never return null pointer, so we could use that as a return type. However, when we use non-null T star, there is a subtle problem there. Okay, you're not going to figure that out anyway, because who knows the interface of non-null T star?
Does it take references instead of pointers?
No, it takes a pointer, that's the annoying thing I mentioned earlier. But non-null T star doesn't provide pointer arithmetic. And you might want to have an allocate function for n t's, and then you want to do arithmetic on that, and you can't do that with non-null t star. So ideally, non-null t star would be really a non-null pointer with arithmetic creation from pointers and a different type for my object ref. No arithmetic creation from objects.
There's no valid
t. Yeah, in this case, we definitely wouldn't want that, because there's no valid t. But again, it's the same concepts, but the concepts don't apply here, because low level. Okay. Lifetime management. We've got a function that constructs an object in memory and a function that destroys an object in memory. Now, first a question, why do I use void star there? I just said we should use byte star.
Because byte star implies readable.
Yeah, I don't think bytestar actually, yeah. Now, there's a different point. We might want to use construct with pointers both coming from a typed and an untyped memory allocator. And when the untyped memory allocator returns bytestar and the typed one tstar, we need a type that's convertible from both, so voidstar. Okay. Which pointer like type do we want there? I say we want a tstar. Why do we want a tstar for construct? It might as well return a reference, because it's a valid object. It's a valid object, has the semantic implications we usually associate with references. However, when it returns a reference, it's very easy to accidentally create a copy. So this is an object getter in a way, so we use T star. Why do I use T star for destroy? And the standard library destroy add I mentioned, shown at the beginning, also uses a T star for the same reason. Yes? Because of the guideline that when you're destroying consuming something, you should make it explicit. This also implies, yes, but there's a more important reason. Let's imagine it would take a reference. This is low-level memory, so we probably have a pointer we want to destroy. So we might write this. And when destroy takes a reference, this will destroy the pointer and not the pointee. that's a nice bug. And when by taking a pointer, we again have the pit of success. Although that doesn't look like a nice pit of success, but anyways. And this was also the rationale in the proposal for destroy at by take a pointer. Now, it takes a non-null pointer, so this would actually be a situation where we want non-null T-star. But it's not in the standard library, so the standard library didn't use non-null T-star. Okay. Wow, now I have so much time left. Yes, Tony.
When you started there with the, you know, your kind of your rules breakdown.
Yeah.
I think part of it is that at that low level, even though it is the only level where you want to have pointers, it's kind of not pointers in that the rest of your stuff is dealing with.
Yeah.
You're now dealing with addresses.
Yeah.
So it's like, think of them as the integer. It's just an address.
Yeah.
And then all your rules will start to apply. Because you're not talking about I'm pointing to a thing. You're talking about addresses.
Yeah.
And now they're just values.
So Tony made an explicit point that at this low level, I'm not actually talking about pointers to something, I'm just talking about some addresses. And it's also the only level where I use T star, because T star, coming from C, basically, has this semantic meaning. This is just some address. All the other types have higher level semantic meaning. It's a pointer to something. So that's also the only level where we're using T star there. Okay. The usual guidelines we give of but people doesn't apply because people usually don't write this piece of code. So let's talk about some odd pointer-like types I haven't mentioned. Reference wrapper. It's an interesting one. It has both implicit and explicit creation because it has a constructor coming from an object that is not explicit, but an explicit standard ref function to create a reference. It has semi-explicit access syntax. It has an implicit conversion operator and a function call operator. But for anything else, you have to cast it. It's non-null and non-owning. So based on my taxonomy, it's a wannabe non-owning non-null alias. Where do we use reference wrapper? We use it when we have an API that has copy by default. Tony, you sit at the wrong place, sorry.
Is operator dot showing up in these slides?
Is operator dot showing up in the slide? No, it doesn't. And at ACCU, someone asked me whether or not I gave a similar talk there. I would have said something different with operator dot. With operator dot, you could implement the, I guess you weren't there when I mentioned that, the missing four quadrant explicit creation, implicit access. And there are some situations where you might want that, like certain kinds of in-out parameters where it's not already obvious, where you want implicit access inside the function for convenience, but explicit creation. However, I don't think it's actually that important to have implicit access in there, so operator dot sort of doesn't apply for this talk. It's more important for proxy objects, and I'm not talking about proxy objects. Okay. So, APIs where we have copy by default, and we want to have references there, like the algorithm copy the predicates around by default. If we don't want that, we can use standard ref. Then we have a predicate ref state, only the reference wrapper is copied around, etc. That's also the reason why reference wrapper has a function call operator to allow this use case. Or standard thread. By default, it copies everything for safety. If we want to reference, we use standard ref. And that's where you use standard reference wrapper. We have an API with copy by default. Use reference wrapper there to turn that around. Okay. And the final pointer-like type for this talk is owner T star from the guideline support library. It's just an alias for T star, so it has the same properties as a T star. And it's non-owning, even though it's called owner, because it's a non-owning nullable reference called owner. And the idea is in legacy code, you can't use smart pointers maybe, so you just want to make it at least explicit that this is a pointer that must be deleted. Or you could imagine the low-level memory allocators that return non-owning references. They could return owner. But to be honest, I don't really think it's a good idea to use that simply because it's not a distinct type. You can still just get a T-star. It's just another name for T-star. Yes?
Alternatively, I really like it because it isn't a distinct type.
all of the overload sets and specializations and everything everywhere work for that, unlike literally any other way that you can express a, this is like this other thing.
So Titus mentioned he likes it because it's not a new type. But I'm guessing you also have to deal a lot more with legacy code than I do. I mean, you have code that is older than I am, right?
Yeah, like the naming, it's a pointer that gets owned.
Yeah, yeah. I personally don't use it, but then again, I can use smart pointers in all my code, so. So I can't also really comment, so anyways. This is what I said in my outline. We are at a point where a simple question, I need to point to something, requires a complicated lecture about war with the smart pointers, references, and the danger of putting references inside angle brackets. Clearly, we can do better. Well, given that this is slide 173 of a C++ NOTARC, apparently we're not. And as Kate Gregory said in her meeting C++ keynote, I'm paraphrasing, you need complex rules to describe a complex system. And this is a complex system, so we need complex rules. There is no simple definitive guideline when to use which pointer-like types, simply because there are so many and so many situations with different semantics, etc. Now, does it need to be such a complex system? Well, there are things that are essential complexity. Nullable versus non-null, we want to decide that. Immutability, our ownership. Those are important questions that need to be answered. However, this is not actually complexity that is required. The distinction between alias versus reference is complexity that we wouldn't actually need in a perfect world. Because in a perfect world, we wouldn't need alias. The situations here all are transparent aliases. We pass a const tref, an in parameter, a for loop, a value getter. We just use const tref because we want to avoid a copy. And in theory, a compiler could do that for us. We just pass by value anywhere there, and the compiler could, in theory, optimize that. He knows a lot better when a type is small and trivially copyable on your particular system. So you could just transparently use an alias there. It doesn't need to be in the language for that. Now, those situations have a non-transparent alias, a tref, in out parameters, for loops, and L value getters. And all those can be solved. You could just use references for in-out parameters, even though that's somewhat more annoying, but it's a reasonable compromise. For loops, if you want mutability, we could have a special language feature, a for loop where we can mutate it, some special syntax that only works there. Or an L-value getter, we could use something like properties in order to solve that problem, or an operator error access equals that takes an index and the value we want to write to that. For example, things like that. It's in a different designed language, we wouldn't need alias. So this is also the need for references introduces a lot of complexity inside C++. So maybe it would have been a better idea to solve the problem differently, not requiring references, just have value types, pointers that are regular. I probably wouldn't have given that talk if that was the case. Yes?
If you want to pass around a shared pointer. So I have a shared pointer, a shared resource, and something that's going to do some sort of reference counting.
Yeah.
But it may or may not, a function that you call may or may not participate in shared ownership.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of want to provide the option to do it. So you wouldn't want to pass it as a value.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't want the compiler to optimize it. You'd want to, I guess, pass it by reference. You'd be some sort of expressing some optionality of participating in shared ownership.
Yeah.
And that would be doable by passing it by.
Yeah, so you mentioned the problem of shared pointer, pass it to a function where you would use const tref.
Yeah, you pass it const tref because you're like, you don't want to pass it by value because you don't, but it may want to.
Yeah, you don't want to pass it by value because, well, when we have like this perfect world, when we pass a function, when we pass by value, what we really do is pass by const tref, and as an optimization, the compiler can turn that into value. So this would actually be valid then. We can just pass it by value and it wouldn't actually copy it.
I think that's what Objective-C ARC does on cases where you're passing it and it determines like well, you don't really need to take a reference count in this case, and I know you're not going to, so it will actually pass by reference like.
Yeah, so Objective-C what?
I think the
automatic reference counting.
Yeah, so it has some automatic in a different
Apple's
language.
Way of saying reference
counting. Yeah.
You should call it Apple reference.
Yeah. Okay, so that was with thinking pointers. You can find all the slides over there. If you follow me on Twitter, I'll also tweet that link out, so no need to copy it. And if you'd like, support me on my Patreon. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
I was thinking the whole time that you completely avoided type erasure, like you said, but the interface of a type erase type, like the thing that sits on the stack or whatever, is an owning pointer-like type that is a transparent alias, or at least tries to be, right?
So you say that I've avoided type erasure, and when you have a type erase type, the wrapper thing, when you do that, well, it's somewhat an owning alias that is transparent. Yeah, I wouldn't say that. I would just say it's a value type. It's like an int. It's not a pointer. It uses a pointer internally, but we don't have to care about that. That's the whole point of using type erasure. Tony.
Back up two slides where it says compiler with three slides. There you go, compiler with three slides. It's almost, I'm saying this almost because I forgot to say it in my talk an hour ago. And I referenced Stepanov papers, and it's that whole thing about make copies distinct and make equal assignment and equality and everything. Just make it work like an integer, make everything regular. And his point is, if you look at what compilers do with integers and things, they'll hoist values out of a loop, or they'll do all these optimizations that compilers can do because they know how an integer works, and they know that this is valid to do it. But they can't do it on a foo class, because they're like, I don't know what if I can hoist this value, because I don't actually know that a copy is as good as the original, right? But programmers do it all the time. It's called programmer optimization. You manually hoist this out of a loop or something like that, because you as a programmer know that copying a foo and, oh, I'm going to make a temporary foo, make some changes, return the old foo to you, right? Like that's a, you know, things that we do normally, some value comes in and I check if it's different than what I already have. If it's not different by equality, then I'm not going to fire off signals to tell everyone it's changed. Well, that equality must be really mean equality, right? So if we one day said, look, all our types are regular, maybe unless we opt out of it or something, then we could have a compiler say, oh, I understand that your types are regular. I can now do all these optimizations that couldn't be possible, that I'm only currently doing with integers, right?
Yeah.
And that was in like Stepanov's paper from 98.
So Tony points out that the compiler can do a lot of optimization with integers because it knows the semantics of integer. And if there was some way to say this type is regular, if you have a copy, you can, it's independent, etc., then the compiler could do some of those things for us today. That is.
And that's very much in line, I think, with stuff that's been going on in terms of like defining concepts for the standard library. They start having semantics.
The internals of the standard library often assume that the programmer has done those optimizations, knowing that the thing you passed is regular.
Right.
Because the STL says everything should be regular, don't be crazy.
Yeah, and the argument of, well, maybe someone wrote their operator equals equals to fire the missiles is carrying less and less weight, and we need to both lean into that and then take advantage of optimizations available once we do that.
So Titus points out that the standard library concept more and more defines semantics, so this is a step in that direction.